Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on.
Hello, boys and girls. Today we're doing requests. We're doing landings with and without a drogue chute. So this is something that was actually suggested, not requested, by a mate of mine who supplied both the IGC data and the TomTom video footage. Yeah, you heard that right, TomTom, not GoPro. Apparently they used to make cameras. Four of us went down to Slovenia last summer to fly the Soča Valley and Liak, where these recordings were made. My mate used his Will's Wing Sport 3 155 on this occasion. He also has a T2C, which he didn't use, so this is the glider that we're using for the comparison. The weather conditions were very similar on both days, slightly stable but good, with a bit of lift that shouldn't have affected the measurements too much. The only problem was that his instrument recorded barometric pressure rather than GPS, which leads to a couple of funny effects in the visualization, and you'll see that after the comparison. And what we've done is we've limited the tracks to the last 100 meters above ground. So here we go, side by side, the comparison. So here we go, 100 meters above ground. Drogue parachute clips on the right. I won't comment too much on what's going on because you can see for yourself. Only one item of note. My mate stated that he felt the most altitude he lost was during the turns when he was using the drogue chute. And he said that it was due to the glider sort of slipping and sliding into the turn. Now, I'm not entirely convinced that that's the case, so I'd be interested to hear from you guys in the comments, those of you that regularly use the drogue chutes, whether you concur that that's the case. What I've done is I've started a timer from the moment that he touches down using the drogue chute to show you how many more seconds you get without one from 100 meters of altitude, and it turns out it's 16 seconds more. Now then, let's have a look at those two tracks visualized simultaneously in Google Earth. So here we are, tracks visualized in Google Earth. The drogue chute track is in yellow, normal ones in green. I tried to visualize this in CU, but for some reason it wouldn't let me align those two tracks nicely because of the different dates that they were recorded on. So that gave me grief and I gave up. So here we are, Google Earth. The artifacting that you can see there on the bottom as both tracks disappear into the ground is the problem I was talking about, and I think it's manageable though. Drogue chute was released at this point here, and we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 turns on the normal track before touchdown, and here we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 before touchdown. My mate and I discussed the format of this video extensively, and also the question arose as to what the key takeaway message should be. Spoiler alert, we couldn't fully agree, so I'll give you both. To me, the key takeaway message is, if you deploy a drogue chute on an intermediate hang glider, it's going to steepen your approach by about a third. I think that's both concrete enough to be useful, as well as simple enough to remember when you're under pressure, which is probably most likely when you're going to deploy the drogue chute. Now, his key takeaway message is deploying the drogue chute is going to significantly reduce the amount of open space that you need to execute your landing, which is, I think, in a roundabout way, saying the same thing, just focusing on a different aspect of it and giving it a different feel, if you like. Here we're looking at the normal landing loaded into the CU software with the average vario displayed down below as a measurement, and you can see that comes in at about 1 meter 40 centimeters per second, which is about 275 feet a minute. By comparison, the landing with the drogue chute comes in at about 2.1 meters per second sink, which equals about 400 feet per minute. comparing the two landing patterns from above, you can see what he's referring to. Yeah, that drogue chute landing path just looks, you know, tight, compact, direct. No frills. Boom, down to the landing. So yeah, I do take his point. So before I let you go, just a bit of science. What we've got here are the polars of an Atos VR at different wing loads. What I've done is I've drawn in what I think probably best approximates the effect of a drogue chute or indeed landing flaps on an Atos and what that does to the polar. I think it's also important to remember that it doesn't really matter. We're looking at an Atos polar in this case, because any aircraft with a wing is going to have a polar. Of course it's going to be different, but they're all going to have one, and in nature it will look like the ones we're looking at, whether that's a paraglider, flex wing, rigid wing hang glider, sailplane, or whatever it might be. So in the diagram you've got the airspeed on the x-axis and you've got the sink in meters per second on the y-axis. The point is also not so much that my guesstimated polar is very accurate. I think it's more about the idea of what happens aerodynamically speaking. And what happens is that the polar gets compressed, so to say, in the direction of the arrow that I've drawn here. My initial thought was that the polar would get shifted just straight down along the y-axis and remain in shape as it is, but that doesn't work because drag increases quadratically as you increase in airspeed due to the high Reynolds number, yada yada yada. So I think that's the main message here, is your polar changes in the way indicated. And that's it. Thank you very much for watching. See you next time. Bye bye.